After 5 years of war, it's almost impossible to determine the exact number of victims. Added to the casualties caused by the conflict are all those who have died at home. Pregnant women, people with cardiovascular diseases, children who should have been vaccinated. Because the past 5 years of war have also been 5 years of attacks on the provision of healthcare. Doctors thrown into jail, patients arrested in their hospital beds, medical centres bombed.
Syrian doctors we were working with were telling us about the humanitarian and medical situation in areas held by the opposition in 2011. And we went public with that information. These doctors were already saying back then how difficult it was for them to treat patients injured during demonstrations and how they had to do it in secret.
Et d'une façon clandestine pour pouvoir soigner des patients qui avaient été blessés lors des manifestations.
Having failed to obtain authorization from the government to work in the country, MSF teams opened in 2012 six hospitals and five outpatient health centers in areas controlled by opposition groups. And in places MSF couldn't access, it set up a support network for Syrian doctors, providing them with drugs and medical supplies. But after the abduction in 2014 of several staff members by so-called Islamic State, almost all the international teams were pulled out of Syria. Unable to obtain guarantees regarding the safety of its teams, MSF is now forced to limit its assistance to providing remote support from neighbouring countries to Syrian doctors, whose work has become even more dangerous than ever.
La situation s'est encore une fois dégradée en 2015.
The situation deteriorated further in 2015 and during the first 3 months of 2016 after the Russian and Syrian air forces stepped up their bombing raids in October 2015. So the health situation is even more dire than before.
La situation sanitaire est encore plus catastrophique qu'avant.
According to our information, 63 hospitals were partially or totally destroyed in 2015. Mostly in airstrikes carried out by Syrian coalition planes.
Given how impossible it's become to deliver medical aid, many doctors have fled the country, especially the Idlib and Aleppo regions that are the target of particularly heavy bombing.
We were risking our lives and we knew they could attack us at any moment. Many of my doctor friends who used to work with me in Aleppo have been killed.
The situation is even worse in towns under siege like Madaya. Despite the intense media coverage of the humanitarian convoys, their inhabitants continue to starve to death. It's estimated that as many as 1.5 to 2 million people are living in areas besieged either by the government or opposition groups.
First off, people are frightened of going to health facilities because they're the target of systematic attacks. And even if they're brave enough, they often don't get the medical care they need because they don't have the necessary drugs to treat, say, heart disease or respiratory problems like asthma or diabetes. Even common illnesses, diarrhea for example, aren't being treated properly in areas under siege because of the drug shortage.
Par exemple, aujourd'hui, ces maladies ne sont pas traitées correctement dans les zones assiégées faute de médicaments.
Confronted with all this, Syrians who can try and leave the country at the first available opportunity. More than 100,000 people are amassed along the Turkish and Jordanian borders, but these borders remain closed. Two-thirds of Syrian refugees in Jordan subsist below the poverty line. Their only source of income is often poorly paid, undeclared work that barely covers the cost of food and rent. Medical care and children's education aren't the main concern. This family arrived in Jordan in November 2012. Just one of their children attends school.
Asma and Khalil haven't gone to school yet because we constantly have to move from one house to another. And there was no space for them in school. The school is overcrowded. Every day they go outside and play in the street with a ball for an hour or so. This is their daily life. their daily routine.
Haunted by memories of Syria, Khalil is being helped by a psychologist from Médecins Sans Frontières. Fear, nightmares, and aggression are the primary symptoms of the 169 patients receiving treatment. Among them are children and teenagers who have seen their loved ones die, their homes destroyed, their families scattered. These people still have far to go to find a country where they'll be able to settle. But for now, their journey is halted by the barbed wire facing them in Idomeni.
The European countries, they have to take their responsibilities and to perhaps for the first time since 1 year to take a common decision in order to solve the situation and to find a really clear options for the refugees.
Now only Syrians and Iraqis are officially allowed to cross the border. But the Macedonian authorities let in just a few hundred people a day, leaving the others, in a state of exhaustion, to wait it out in appalling conditions. In its medical center there, Médecins Sans Frontières teams are tending to people who are increasingly exhausted and increasingly vulnerable.
She told us her foot has been like this since she walked through Turkey in the snow for a week. They had a piece of paper with them, a health card describing the first medical consultation she had with our MSF colleagues on the island of Samos.
34,000 people are trapped in Greece, yet the country can accommodate only 3,000. This is an emergency that Greece can't manage without help from its neighbours. Twenty-one-year-old Mo goes first. When the revolution began in March 2011, he posted his support on Facebook and quickly ended up in prison. Then it's 27-year-old Abaida's turn. After being wounded by a shell in his home in Idlib in 2013, he decided to leave Syria. Salim is last. Age 32, she has two children. In 2011, her husband was arrested and tortured to death for taking part in anti-regime protests. Her village is bombed frequently. Mo's turn. After a year in prison, he's finally released and immediately gets on a plane to Egypt. But the casual work he finds is barely enough to cover the rent for the room he sleeps in. Now in Turkey, Abaida's going to attempt the crossing from Izmir to Greece. He pays $850 to board a small inflatable boat that has 43 other passengers. There's no room for discussion. The smuggler is armed. Salim flees from the bombing and enters Turkey, where she too decides to take her two children across the Aegean Sea. They land on the island of Lesbos. But while at sea, Salim loses the drugs she needs to take every day to treat her heart condition. Mo, in Egypt, sees trying his luck in Europe as the only way to make a decent life for himself. He gets to Libya, and along with 45 other people, he boards a wooden fishing vessel. Ubaida is less than an hour away from the Turkish coast when a boat approaches. The Coast Guard? No. A group of men dressed in black who destroy the boat's engine before taking off again. Salim takes the ferry from Lesbos to Athens and then travels through Macedonia and Serbia to Hungary. While waiting for a train to Vienna, someone steals her phone and 200 euros. But she has no choice. They have to keep going. Mo arrives in Italy and is met by the police. After a month in prison, the authorities force him to apply for asylum before letting him go in a field in the middle of nowhere. Abaida's boat starts taking in water. Panicked, the passengers transmit their GPS coordinates to the Greek Coast Guard. But they're still in Turkish waters, so it's the Turks who turn up and take them back to where they'd left from. Obaida spends 10 days in a detention centre before being released with a document that gives him 1 month to leave the country. Salim arrives in Calais, where doctors give her the medication she needs to treat her heart condition. While waiting to be able to join her father in the UK, she and her children live in a tent in the jungle camp. Released, Mo leaves Italy for France and then Germany, where he can apply for asylum without being deported back to Italy. He lives in a camp while waiting for the response to his application, but he's not allowed to work. Obaida decides to try his luck again and pays $1,000 for another crossing. But yet again he fails. His boat is intercepted by the Turkish police. He manages to escape and returns in despair to Idlib in Syria. Mo, Obaida and Salim are just three of the 4,600,000 refugees forced to flee Syria since the beginning of the war. In January 2016 alone, 368 migrants died at sea. But as the country becomes even more mired in conflict, taking to the road is for many the only choice, however arduous it may be.
هاي كامب نجي نقعد فيها على أساس بدو يشيلو بدو يشيلو ما فينا وين بدنا ننام ما برا ما فينا ننام هلا يعني أقل شيء بدنا نروح على أساس قطعنا هاي كل شيء مشان نروح على بريطانيا بريطانيا قريبة منا وما بياخذونا 45 كيلو متر وما بياخذونا يعني بيشوفونا بيجوا لعنا وما بياخذونا هون مثل حيوانات نحن يعني أنا بدي أروح على بريطانيا بدي أشوف حياتي من جديد يعني بدي أنسى السورية كلها يعني من جدودكم ساعدونا أنا بدي أروح على بريطانيا بدي أروح عند أخوي بأكي شوف أدرس هنيك بعمل شي هنيك بشتغل بعمل شي يعني مستقبلي بأكي أدرس أعمل شي عند أخوي أنا لساتي صغير ما بعرف شي يعني أنا شو بدي أعمل هون الدنيا نحن عمرنا 17 سنة صار لنا 5 سنين سوريا خربت كل شيء يعني ما في مدرسة ما في شيء يعني ما شفنا شيء
اللي ماشي ما عاد يعرف وين بده يروح واللي قاعد مش مأمن على حاله
حالات انعدام الأمان والعدالة والاستقرار إنسان يضطر
هناك اعتقاد أنه نحن في وطننا أموات نموت أحسن ما نبقى أموات هناك
مشينا بهالبحر شوي وبنغرق شوي وبنغرق لما طلعنا بالسفينة تبع الإنقاذ كأنه انولدنا من جديد
سوريا هون نسمى هون ما بتروح من بالي سوريا